My name is Maciej. I work for CSIRO as a synthetic biology stack developer, which means that I work on developing high-throughput techniques in CSIRO for synthetic biology. I work with hardware, I work with software, I work with the molecular biology layer as well, a little bit. So I try to integrate all this into workable solutions for biofoundry technology in Australia. So let's start with, so I'm taking you to this crazy world of machine learning today. And just a small preamble, I'll simplify some things just to make the presentation flow better. But if you have specific mathematical questions or questions about models or anything, just hit my email. I'm very much happy to answer those. So what is machine learning? So machine learning is basically a family of algorithms that can improve themselves. They are not very homogeneous. Actually, the whole family is pretty heterogeneous. There are a multiple number of techniques. So it's not like if you say I'm using machine learning, there is a number of techniques that you can really use and they are interchangeable or not. It's a very wide area actually. And why do we talk about machine learning nowadays that much? There are two reasons. One of those reasons is the advances in hardware, in actual computer hardware. So there is a computer component called the GPU, which is used mostly for graphical calculations, but people figure out that it's very good also in machine learning calculations. So since the computing power of those GPUs has increased a lot recently, usability of machine learning also went up a lot. And also the algorithm gets upgraded over time. So it's a very well in development discipline. A lot of algorithms are being upgraded and made better as we speak. And one thing about machine learning, it requires large data sets. So as my machine learning mentor likes to say, the data sets that you think are big are not. You really need thousands of data points usually. If you get your experiment designs well, maybe hundreds are enough, but usually we're talking in the numbers of hundreds and thousands. So those are the numbers that we have to be talking about to really start considering using machine learning. So how we do this, we are fortunate enough to have access to the CSIRO Biofoundry based in Brisbane. And we are a member of the Global Biofoundry Alliance. We collaborate with the Australian Genome Foundry in Macquarie University. And basically what we are is a semi-automated facility where we can process many more variants of different genetic constructs much faster and in much reliable and reproducible way, which gives us this volume of data set that we can use for machine learning. So that's our main advantage. But actually, how do we use this? So all of you probably know this well-known and at this point an immortal idea of design, build, test, learn cycle in synthetic biology. And many of you do it every day. So you start with a design, you build it, you test it, and then sometimes you learn from it, sometimes not. But for the most part, that's the idea, right? And now the problem with this is that if you are doing only a few designs every cycle, it's not very efficient. So of course you can learn things and you can optimize your constructs or designs, but it's a slow process and we know all that. So with usage of hardware, meaning automation, you can increase the speed of building and testing, right? But even if you build and test thousands of cells, it doesn't really help you that much because at this point, just drawing a regression in Excel, it's not gonna cut it. You need something better. And that's where machine learning comes in because it actually can learn from this number of cells. So you pretty much increase the number of cells that you're producing or genetic variants, or it's all interchangeable really. So you have to design those hundreds or thousands of variants, then you have to build them and test using the Biofoundry, then you learn using machine learning, and then you can design next round another hundred of thousands or maybe less, depending on what the algorithm will tell you. So this is the premise. And so how we decided to, what is a good problem to start with? So we had the biofoundry, we have the machine learning, but now let's find a problem that we can solve with it, that we can show that actually the whole idea is working. So all of you know the RBS, the ribosome binding site, it controls the protein expression level. And the RBS is a good target because usually when you want to change the expression level of a protein, you start with RBS. Changing promoters is cumbersome and it's not as stable as changing the RBS. So this is where you usually start. So RBS can be described in what we call the translation initiation rate of a ribosome, of an RBS, sorry. Bindings is a hard, but it's hard to predict and it's expensive to label. And now this is coming from machine learning jargon. In machine learning jargon, you have features and labels. Features are the things that you are actually testing. So this would be RBS sequences in our case, and labels are the actual results. So you have features and labels. So it's features are actually, you can think of it as X and labels are Y. So what I'm trying to say here is creating a lot of RBSs and trying to find one that's working for you and expressing the protein on the level that you are satisfied is not easy, expensive and slow. And you can use RBS calculators. There are quite a few on the market, but they are not very good. And there are a few reasons for that. One of the main of those reasons is that they are based on thermodynamic data and thermodynamic calculations. And because the numbers that are used in those models are not super precise, and you need a lot of those to actually describe the RBS, the error is multiplied and you end up with not very good predictions for those RBS. So even if you use RBS predictor, you usually end up with 30 or 40 different sequences you have to test to find a good one. Not a great solution. And yeah. And we think we can make it better with use of machine learning. So what's actually the objective? So it boils down to assigning each sequence a normalized protein expression level or TRR. So the transcription initiation rate doesn't really matter how you call that number. The point is that the number has to be the same, or the type of the number has to be the same for your all RBSs. That allows you to tell if an RBS is strong or weak, and to order them basically, right? So in our case, we decided to focus on the core of the RBS. So you probably know that RBS in E. coli, and we are working with E. coli in this case. RBS of E. coli is made of 20 base pairs, usually, and they start just before ATG codon, and they go 20 downstream, sorry. And they have a specific core, and this core is usually between -5 and -15. And that's what we decided to work on. So we set the first seven, the last seven base pairs of the RBS, and we change only the core. So that gives us no less but 4,096 possibilities in total to be checked. Of course, we don't want to check that many. We want to check as little as we can, and only then, and we hope that this, say, maybe 600, maybe 500 will tell us how the rest of it looks like, or the design space, right? So this is quite easy to do, actually. So the genetic design is very simple. We have a promoter, we have an RBS that is being changed using just a PCR and a isothermal assembly. And we have a GFP that processes the label. And the label in our case will be the fluorescence over time. And one thing that we did is to set it under an inducible promoter. So we can, when we start growing the cells, we can make sure that all of them start expressing the GFP at the same time, at the time of testing. So it doesn't, so we don't have this extra layer of uncertainty. So on practical layer, how we do it, we order primers in ready-to-use plates. We set up the PCR reactions using our acoustic liquid handler, which is the Upside Echo. We do the PCR. We do quality control for the PCRs in our DNA analyzer. After analysis, they go for another go at the echo to create the actual assembly reactions for the isothermal assembly. We do the isothermal assembly. The transformation is handled all automatically using the liquid handler that we have. Next, they go for, so the plate after outgrowth and growth and incubation for overnight, they go into our automated colony picker. The colonies are picked, they grow into deep well plates, and after they are done, they for another outgrowth and another incubation overnight, they go both to microplate photometry in citation, and we do flow at the same time. So we gather a lot of labels. So each RBS is then characterized with time series of fluorescent growth. And also at some point we do flow cytometry on the same cultures to make sure that the numbers that we are getting are correct and the order is correct. So we designed a few rounds of those experiments. I'll focus on the round zero, as we called it, because when we started the experiments, it was January. We had the zero round, which was 180 different RBS, has been finished in February, and then the COVID happened, and we couldn't really go to another round, but it's almost ready. We are back in the lab now, and I hope we'll have more very soon. So we decided to do a few different, because we didn't have previous data to learn on. So we did a few different groups that we wanted to try. One of those groups, we wanted to simulate kind of evolution. So what we did is for all 20 base pairs, we one by one, we exchanged them for all other different bases, possible bases. So that gives us 60 different. Then to scan the experimental space a little better, we created a group that was just random, and 30 of those were uniformly random. Then we used probability-based randomness as well to generate another 30, and this probability came from how often in natural RBS a given base shows up at a given position. And finally, we found a data set previously published in literature describing similar experiment to ours, but on much smaller data set. And we used that to teach our algorithm a little bit more about how it should be done. We have two algorithms that we work for. One is for learning, one is for designing. For learning, we have Bayesian regression algorithm, which predicts the whole mean and uncertainty of the function that assigns a label to a feature, so a TRR to a sequence. And we have so-called multi-arm Bayesian algorithm, and in its upper confidence bound version to choose designs. I'll show it in a graphical version in a moment, so it's much easier to understand. But before that, we also have to, of course, sequence is not numerical, so we need to turn the sequence into a number. And we use a few tricks to do that. And they create a very complicated multidimensional matrix that tells us about different interactions between different sequences. But that doesn't mean that you cannot visualize, you can actually visualize that kind of data. So there are a few ways. In this case, we used an algorithm called TESNI. And with TESNI, you can take all this very highly dimensional data space and kind of compact it into 2D, and you can visualize how different sequences lie between each other, which is very useful because each of different type of figure tells you that they are considered by the algorithm as a group, and this grouping can be very useful when you are choosing what to test next. And speaking of testing, so our algorithm for both learning and designing can be put together and eventually it's called Gaussian process upper confidence bound. Not really that important how it's exactly called, but how it works is So the algorithm, let me just turn on my laser. So so the orange thing here is the actual function. So this is the actual assignment of sequence to label, right? Or to the TRR. Our algorithm, our Gaussian process, predicts how it thinks it looks like based on the current data. So it predicts that the function is probably the blue line, and the uncertainty, or how it could be actually, where it actually can be, is the blue shading here. So you have the blue shading, and so the blue parts are predicted by the algorithm, orange is the real part. So what algorithm does is it chooses points in the whole probability that it wants to test, and in our case, it chooses upper confidence. So it chooses the points that are the highest. And there is some balance to be made between exploration and exploitation. Exploitation means that you just choose the highest points, just you want to find the highest point as soon as possible. And there's also exploration where you are trying to actually find out how the function, the whole function looks like, because you don't need to know how the whole function looks like if you just want the highest RBS, right? So it chooses this point. We test this point in the BioFoundry, and then this point is now tested. The algorithm recalculates how the function looks like, and now it looks like more like its actual shape, and then it chooses another point for us, and this continues over a number of rounds. So in our zeroth round, we did a few different groups, as I mentioned. Unfortunately, none of those groups hit at least the benchmark, which is here. So this is the highest RBS that we know exists, and we use it as a benchmark. But that's not a problem. I mean, it's a bit of a problem, but the good thing is in machine learning, you actually learn from your failures, right? So this is a great thing about machine learning. The good results are great, but the bad results are also good because you can use them to improve the algorithm, right? So this is a very good thing, because usually in life sciences, bad results go straight to the trash. We actually use them. We use them to learn. Because of time, I'll skip this. It's not that important. But eventually, how this whole workflow looks like. So you start with a design, as we said. You build it in the machine. You test them in the machine. Later, we wrote algorithms that allow us for data preprocessing. We do the spectrum kernel. That's the way of making the sequence into a number. Then we use the Gaussian process regression, so the prediction of how the function looks like. It predicts mean and variance for us. Then we do the upper confidence bound. So we find the highest points, and they are being tested later on in the BioFoundry. We choose n RBS sequences. In our case, we usually use 90, choose 90, because this is how many you can fit into a microplate, and it's the unit that we work with in the BioFoundry. We do, for example, 4 rounds of this, and we are trying to see how the experimental space looks like after this. So in future, you can, of course, make it much bigger. So instead of just focusing on one RBS, you can start having many more features and many more labels, and you can do metabolomics. So instead of just relying on our GFP signal, you are doing full metabolomics on the whole thing. And it's a much more complicated project. So we started with RBS. But if you are interested in collaborating in something like this, just let us know. Eventually, you want to get there. So with this, I wanted to thank the BioFoundry team, especially Hugh, who made most of those experiments here, and my collaborators from Data61, the machine learning people. And I wanted to thank both Claudia and Chengsun for funding this project and listening to my crazy ideas and agreeing to fund this. So with this, thank you very much for listening, and let's open the floor for questions.
We've got a whole heap of questions. First one came in from Leonardo, and he asks, how could you take advantage of all the previously published data of RBS characterization to complement this type of study?
Okay, I to describe the quality of the currently available data, I would have to use bad words. but basically, it's very hard. Before we started this research, we went through probably 50 or 60 data sets, and oh, wow. Each of them have a problem. And usually those problems are non-reproducibility or very poor design choices for the experiments that really for machine learning, you need to have very tight data, I would call it. So your standard deviations have to be low and everything. And automation helps with that because you eliminate pretty much human error unless you design it wrong. And if you design it wrong, yeah. So I'm sorry to say most of the data sets that we found are bad. The only data set that we found usable was actually from a group that did machine learning study. So
we've got another question from Anonymous. Does the final ranking you get from testing GFP hold through for the expression of other proteins?
Potentially. Of course, it's not necessarily true. But the good thing about algorithm is after you figure out how to do these things, because there is a lot of things to consider. But if you have the algorithm, then you can use the algorithm to improve your process for other proteins. We don't know yet how it will work for other proteins, but as we move to a more advanced project with metabolic engineering in mind, we hope to learn that as well.
Anonymous asks, I imagine by now RBSs have been extensively studied. No large scale studies of RBS have been performed. That's not really a question.
Yeah, because, yes, no big scale study has been done because people, A, it's not that glamorous to do, if you know what I mean. If you cannot build something around it, just testing this many RBSs is not that useful, really. Like it's like paper called, I've tested 5,000 RBSs and I found a good one. Doesn't read very well. And I think also with introduction of biofoundries and with machine learning, it makes more sense because in the time that, the variants of RBS are being produced, which is not very useful time if you think about the time of postdoc or PhD student, that's not very good use of their time, but our machines do their thing and we can do other stuff in the meantime, right? So it's easier for us also to justify doing mundane stuff, maybe you would call it.
Ah, beautiful. So this one's from Alex, and he asks, do you worry that you might be optimizing your machine learning approach for cooperation with your specific promoter rather than promoters in general?
Yes, definitely. There's a problem, right? You have to... Well, of course, in biology, it's impossible to detach, as we talked about CDS already, right? And promoter also influences the RBS in some way, especially if there are things like, hairpins being made that you don't think about, right? Because you are looking only on those 6 or 20 base pairs, right? You could probably extend the sequence that you are looking at. So at the promoter and the CDS as well, but that makes the potential experimental space into billions and gagillions probably at some point, right? So yeah, there is some balance to be stricken, and I'm not ready to answer the question fully because we don't know yet, but definitely it's being taken into account that of course, the sequence, even, sequence on the genome or somewhere could influence what you are doing, right? So you never know, but it's still better than just not thinking about it at all and not trying to assess the RBS in any way.
Thank you again, Majek, for your fantastic talk.
No worries. Thank you.